question is, how did they get to that? From this.
When people think about what makes a tank good, they often think about armor, firepower, and mobility. The golden triangle of tank design. But there's a lot more to tank design than just those three aspects. You could make a tank with a perfect combination of all three and still end up with a bad tank. In fact, that same situation has played out multiple times throughout history. Not only that, but what makes a tank good can depend entirely on the military doctrine of the nation using it. A great tank for one nation might be a bad tank for another. So what are the other aspects that make up an objectively good tank? First is reliability. If your tank is spending more time in the repair shops instead of on the battlefield, it's not a good tank, even if it has the best armor and the best gun around. What matters above all else is simply getting the tank into the action. Not only should the tank's components have a relatively long service life, but they should also be easy to access for maintenance and replacement. The tank should also have a large and readily available stockpile of spare parts. In World War II, the Panthers' reliability suffered in part because they were too occupied with producing more Panthers, instead of producing spare parts for the existing ones. Second is transportability. Again, getting to the fight is the most important thing. If your tank is too big or too heavy, you're limiting your transportation options. Specifications like the width of train tunnels, maximum rail car weight, shipping capacity, and ability to be transported by air all have a major impact on a tank's design. For example, if you make a light tank just a few tons heavier so you can have a bit more armor, you could eliminate its capability for deployment by air. Being able to deploy your tanks in areas the enemy doesn't expect is extremely useful. Third is modularity. You could make the best tank in the world today, but in 10 years it could be the worst, if you don't leave any room for future improvements. Not only does technology rapidly advance, but combat scenarios can change drastically depending on the type of war that you're fighting, or what environment you're fighting in. Tanks have to be able to be effective for multiple decades before being replaced. Tanks like the M1 Abrams and Leopard 2 have been in service for around 40 years now, and are still going strong. It'd be a waste of money to build the perfect tank today only to have it be outclassed in a decade. That leads into the next point. Fourth is cost. A countless number of promising tank prototypes have been cancelled either because the program itself was too costly, or the end product would have been unaffordable. A tank has to be effective while also being cheap enough that you can convince the brass that the thing is actually worth producing. And the cheaper the tank is, the more of them you can produce. It goes without saying that the more tanks you can produce in field, the more overall coverage you can give to infantry, with the infantry being the most important element in holding territory. Fifth is crew ergonomics. The more uncomfortable a crew is, the more fatigued they will become, and their work will suffer as a result. You need to account for amenities like storage space, heating equipment, ventilation, air conditioning, overall space, seating options, and even something to heat up meals. The definition of good crew ergonomics can change depending on the doctrine. Sixth is fire control equipment. This could theoretically be tied into firepower, but I believe most people simply think of firepower as whatever has the most powerful gun. In combat, the first tank to fire is the victor, at least the majority of the time. So the faster you can spot and accurately lay onto a target, the better your chances of survival. Stabilizers, thermal imaging, rangefinders, ballistic computers, commander overrides, and fast turret drives are all crucial in ensuring that a target is engaged quickly. And finally, there's survivability. This could also be tied into armor protection, but I think they're distinct enough that survivability warrants its own category. Survivability is a tank's ability to protect its crew after the armor has been penetrated. This can include spall liners, number of hatches to escape out of, wet ammunition stowage, blowout panels, automatic fire suppression, compartmentalization, and even the density of crew members slash components. A tank can be replaced somewhat easily, but crew members cannot. Despite the obvious value of human life, there's also the time and money it takes to train an effective tank crew. In conclusion, tank design is a difficult balancing act. The different aspects will often outright contradict one another. What matters is providing a reliable, cost-effective, upgradable, and easy-to-transport tank that fits the doctrine and role that it is placed into. And that's about all I have to say. As always, I hope you guys enjoyed the video.